I'm Michael Rackemann. I'm a judge of the Planning and Environment Court for the state of Queensland in Australia. Today I've been asked to speak to you about case management. I'll be speaking to you about what I perceive to be good case management, at least from my perspective and in my context. I'm conscious that your context may be different. From my perspective, good case management should be active, it should be continuous, it should be efficient in both time and expense. It should be individual, flexible, and straightforward. Importantly, it should be focused on a resolution of the issues in a problem-solving way. Environmental disputes are different from ordinary civil litigation. Whilst environmental disputes arise between parties, they typically involve a subject matter which is of broader interest. The environment is the silent or third party in such cases. Delay and obfuscation is the enemy, not only of doing justice between the parties, but of achieving an appropriate environmental outcome. For these reasons, environmental courts cannot simply allow cases to languish while the parties prepare them in their own good time. Active case management is required. In the Planning and Environment Court, that starts at the very outset. The first thing which parties are required to do in any proceeding before the Planning and Environment Court is to bring the matter to court before a judge in order for the case management to start. That case management will then be continuous until such time as the matter is finally disposed of. So, accordingly, following the first directions hearing, the matter will simply not be adjourned off to an unspecified date in the future. Rather, the parties will be given further specified dates when the matter will be brought back on before a judge in order to review the preparation and to adjust the case management as may be required to suit the case and the circumstances which have arisen. As important as active and continuing case management is, it is, of course, not an end in itself. It is a tool to achieving efficiency and effectiveness. There are courts and tribunals whose enthusiasm for the concept of case management has overflown to a situation where they have made a myriad of unnecessary directions which have simply served to increase delay and expense rather than achieve efficiency. In the case of the Planning and Environment Court, case management is carried out with an express objective of achieving the just and expeditious resolution of the real issues in the matter at a minimum of expense. A helpful starting point to ensuring that case management does not lead to delay is to set a trial date, or at least a month in which the trial will be held from the very outset. And so if I was hearing the very first directions hearing of a new matter today in May, I would typically order that the matter be heard and determined in August, unless it is earlier resolved by way of agreement. It is that end point set right from the beginning which provides focus for both the court and the parties in ensuring the prompt and efficient disposal of the matter. My experience is that courts and tribunals which leave things open-ended from the start and only think about setting trial dates once a case is fully prepared end up in causing undue delay and expense. Efficiency, both in terms of time and cost, can also be achieved by having individual and flexible as well as straightforward case management. Some courts or tribunals carry out case management by streaming cases at a registry level. That is, they will have formulated standard directions for a limited number of categories of cases. As a case is filed, someone in the registry will have a look at that case, identify what generic type of case it is, and then administratively apply the standard directions for cases of that generic kind. The Planning and Environment Court does not do that. The Planning and Environment Court requires each case to come before a judge to be reviewed and permits individual directions to be given for that case and to be tailored in a way which best suits the efficient and effective disposition of that matter. As the court's published practice direction on case management states, there is no standard suite of orders or directions which is required in each case. The procedure used in any proceeding can be as simple or as comprehensive as is appropriate in the circumstances. Accordingly, each party is to give conscientious consideration to the orders or directions which are appropriate for the particular proceeding, and a draft order should provide for a procedure which is as simple and as cost-effective as is practical in order to achieve a just and expeditious resolution of the real issues in the proceeding at a minimum of expense. The emphasis, therefore, is on timeliness, simplicity, efficiency, but also flexibility to apply such measures to the case at hand as will achieve those outcomes. Further, having a flexible individual case management approach rather than a streaming exercise at a registry level allows for innovation. From time to time, new ideas will emerge, either new ideas as to how to deal with the particular circumstances of a given case, or new ideas as to how things might be better done more generally. The individual case management approach permits the court to trial or to implement these new ideas from case to case as it wishes. And in that way, allow case management to ever evolve and to be ever tailored without having to change any of the court's rules or practice directions. It simply changes the content of what is ordered in a particular case or from time to time. The last two features of case management that I referred to, that is, that it be resolution focused and on the basis of a problem solving approach, are perhaps the two most significant and those for which the Planning and Environment Court has some reputation. Most cases in most jurisdictions resolve by agreement without the need for a final hearing and determination by a court. That is true of many courts. It is true of the Planning and Environment Court, where something less than 10% of our cases go to a final hearing. Accordingly, it makes no sense at all to carry out case management simply with an eye to a final trial. Case management must recognise that what you are managing is a case which is most likely to settle, but which might go to trial. And accordingly, case management has to be as much directed towards resolution as it is towards determination. The Planning and Environment Court certainly has an emphasis on dispute resolution. The parties are required to give consideration to a dispute resolution plan, the particular content of which is set in the directions given in the case management in each case. That dispute resolution plan will typically involve the court's alternative dispute resolution registrar, who is a former senior practitioner, now employed by the court, who provides mediation and other dispute resolution services free of cost to the parties. What is important, however, in having resolution-focused case management is to remember that the objective is not simply to maximise the number of cases which are resolved by agreement. Particularly given the wider public interest in environmental cases, it is important that cases resolve because of a satisfactory process and with a satisfactory outcome. It is not in the public interest that environmental cases resolve because people run out of money or are bought out or simply intimidated by the process. The losers in that scenario potentially include the environment and the public good. Rather, it is better if an environmental dispute is resolved as a product of a problem-solving exercise where earnest consideration has been given to the subject matter of the dispute, where environmental impacts and potential impacts have been identified, and where the measures that are available for mitigation or avoidance of those impacts have also been carefully considered in order to arrive at a solution which not only is appropriate for the parties, but which involves an appropriate environmental solution to the underlying problem or issue. And that's what I mean by a problem-solving approach. So how does the Planning and Environment Court conduct its case management in order to be resolution-focused on the basis of a problem-solving approach? It does that by managing not just the parties, but importantly by managing the experts as well. If you are going to talk about impacts and ways of addressing those impacts, typically one must bring into account the scientific expertise on the matters in question, the findings of the ecologists, the fauna experts, the flora experts, the air pollution experts, whoever they may be. In the Planning and Environment Court, we manage the experts and we manage them in conjunction with the dispute resolution process. The parties will be able to nominate their experts and to pay them, retain them. But importantly, the experts are required to put their duty to the court above any duty to their client, and their professional objectivity is not only expected but required. In order to foster and protect that objectivity, the court requires the experts to go through a joint meeting and report process so that after they've been engaged and after the party engaging them has given them the relevant material and told them what the issue is that they'll have to look at, but before they commit themselves in writing to any position in any report for the court requires them for a period usually of 3 or 4 weeks to work collectively and collaboratively with the experts nominated by the other party or parties. During that time, and subject to some limited exceptions, the experts are quarantined from communication with the parties or their lawyers. That is, they are allowed and required to work on the problem collectively, collaboratively, in a professional way, rather than be involved in the exercise of preparation by reference to their own clients in anticipation of an adversarial battle at a trial. The result of that joint meeting process is a joint report which is provided to the court. Experience has shown that this provides a much higher quality and reliable information basis for both the court and the parties to then consider the resolution or determination of the matter. Typically, one will get a report where the experts from both sides will say something to the effect of, yes, we both acknowledge that this proposal has its difficulties and potential impacts in these respects, but we also both acknowledge and agree that those impacts are capable of being addressed in one of a number of different ways, of which these are examples. Once that joint report has been produced, the parties are then required to go into a mediation process, usually with the ADR registrar, in which not only the parties, but their lawyers and the experts all participate. The experts, again, are treated as a resource of knowledge and scientific expertise to assist the parties, rather than being quasi-advocates. This ordinarily results in either a complete resolution of the issues, or at least a substantial narrowing of them. And where matters are resolved, they're typically resolved because the underlying concerns about environmental impact, which have caused the dispute in the first place, have been investigated, addressed, and overcome to the satisfaction of the parties, and with an appropriate outcome for the environment. That's a much more satisfactory basis for matters to settle. But also, it's a very good way of case preparation, because if the dispute resolution phase fails to reach a complete resolution, the matter then proceeds to trial, but only on the basis of what remains as an area of disagreement. It is at that point then that the parties, that the experts come out of the quarantining process and can again communicate with their clients and their clients' lawyers and get ready for trial, but again, only on that very limited basis. And all of this happens in the context of the overall time limit, the overall time deadline that's been set from very early in the piece to ensure that the process does not drag out. Well, that's a very brief overview of case management in the Planning and Environment Court. I'm conscious that it's been brief, but my time is limited and I've already exceeded mine. I thank you for the invitation. I wish you well and stand ready to help you in any way I can. Thank you.